Our YouTuber friend Marius Hornberger is building some edge clamps, and he wanted to know what type of joint is strongest for those.
So he made a whole lot of samples with different types of joinery so I could test them with my joint strength testing machine. Except I can't actually put a sample in here like this.
So I'm just going to build a jig to turn my compression tester into a tensile tester. So now if the screw jack lifts on here, I can have my test piece attached to here and here, and that pulls this part apart. So I've got a carriage bolt that comes in from underneath. And then here I've got a half a coupler nut with a hole drilled through it. That takes the pin for attaching the joint. And the screw jack goes on this side. And I've got a notch for positioning this board on here. And then the beam goes on top of here. And this has got a little peak to make sure the force is applied at the right distance. And the threaded rod comes in from the top, also with a coupler nut on the end of it. And the test piece goes in here. And I'll just snug that up a bit. Now normally I make a few extra test samples just to set up the test setup with. I don't have that, so I'm going to use a dummy sample just to make sure the setup works. So that's pulling 130 kilograms now. We're seeing some slight bending on the beam there, because right now that says it's about 300 kilograms pulling on my dummy sample. Whoa! And looking at this bit here, it's definitely the specimen that broke here. And I made a second, more realistic sample to get a better sense of how much force to actually expect. So, plywood broke apart here. Now that I'm confident in the setup, I'm testing the actual samples from Marius. First one is a regular mortise and tenon joint. And I can see some slight gaps opening there already, currently at 70 kilograms. I can hear some creaking. Definitely seeing quite a bit of flex there now. Yeah, that's bent outwards by quite a bit there. So it's opened up by this much. Okay, whoa! Now the failure wasn't the joint at all, it was just the wood right here. And the fail strength was 121 kilograms. Next up, a bridle joint, and I want to see better how much this flexes, so I'm just going to stick this piece of wood in here. That'll make that more obvious. At 50 kilograms, it hasn't opened up much. 80, 90, 100, and you can see it opened up quite a bit already. 120, 125, and we broke the wood again. So that was a bridle joint. Intuitively, we'd expect that this sort of a double bridle joint to be stronger, but we weren't really testing a joint because the wood broke here. Same with this one here. So these more complicated joints, like a double mortise and tenon joint, aren't gonna help any if the wood breaks. But we've got two plywood samples here which are not gonna split apart on the end, so I'll try those next. This one's Baltic birch plywood. I have no idea where it will break, because there isn't really a joint, it's all just plywood. Is the plywood itself gonna crack apart? Is it gonna fail here? So that's 70 kilograms now. And we can see it opened up a fair bit, so there is some kind of flexing in the wood already. Holy crap, that piece is so bent now. 240. I just hope I don't break my test setup. Something's gotta give. 270. 275. Okay, something. Come on, come on. Fail. Something's gonna fail. Let it not be the test apparatus, which is a little bit bent out of shape by now. Oh! Okay, and the wood itself failed here. And the final fail strength, my lines wrapped around here a bit, was 280 kilograms. 230. Whoa! So this one broke right here, but at 238 kilograms, it was pretty close to the other plywood sample. With the frame splitting apart at the end, I wasn't learning anything about the strength of those joints. So I decided to consult Marius to figure out how to proceed.
Genau.
I decided to try reinforcing the ends of the joints, first with the ones I already broke and glued back together, just to make sure that would actually work.
So these would be ready for retesting, except Marius pointed out there needs to be a hole drilled through here like this, where the clamping screw goes through, so I have to add that too, because that potentially weakens the frame. So it's opening up quite a bit. 80, 90, 100, 110, this is about where it failed before. So the amount of flex here makes this not such a usable clamp frame anymore. 135. Oh, I think it's starting to yield now. Oh, force is dropped a little bit. So it looks like those mortise and tenon joints are starting to pull apart now. And the force has dropped enough now that it's declared failed, and I'm pretty sure this is just pulling out here now. And this is the repaired bridle joint. So this got up to 146, which is more than before I fixed it, and it broke here, which is not the place I glued it, so a new failure. With both of the repaired reinforced ones failing at the joint or near the joint, I figured that was a good idea, so off camera I did the rest of them. Lots of flex here, and looks like it's pulling out. So glue failed on this one, and it's just kind of popped out the edge here. Next, the bridle joint, which doesn't have this extra piece of wood on top here, but I don't think that held much. That's more than the last one already. This one failed a lot like the other bridle joint, with an outside part just kind of popping off. So this is a double mortise and tenon joint, which should have a lot more glue area. I expect this to be stronger. So this is now more than the bridle joint had. But it's definitely... Whoa! It's definitely starting to fail, I was going to say. I added a screw here and a screw here, which loosely hold this together so that the flying pieces don't end up hitting the camera. And this one mostly failed in the wood, but you can see here it's a rather unfortunate grain orientation, and the reinforcement itself failed on this one too. And next, the double bridle joint, or finger joint as Marius calls it. That one should be the strongest if the wood doesn't fail. I wonder where it's failing here. Well, that's the strongest one so far. Looks like it might be failing around the hole here. Well, it hasn't popped apart, but the deflection of this makes it kind of unusable. Yes, there's definitely something opening up around the hole. And the force has dropped enough that it's declared failed. 180 kilograms, but the peak was 202. And here's a second double mortise and tenon joint one. And this second double mortise and tenon joint had an interesting failure. I'd say this hole in here definitely contributed. The single mortise and tenon failed the earliest, both pulling out at 123 and 141. Next, the bridle joint, both of these failed with the wood splitting apart here. Then the double mortise and tenon joints, one failed around the hole, and the other one had this part break. I guess the reinforcement wasn't strong enough. And the finger joint, this one here, failed pretty much the same way. This one split around the hole, and this one failed at the reinforcement. But the strongest failures was the plywood parts, because these don't split here, and this one just tore right here. But This is before I drilled that hole in here. And these holes I drilled here actually took away more than half the wood. So to make this a fair comparison, I made some more plywood parts, and I expect these to fail at probably less than half the force. And why that big hole? Well, that's Marius's clamp design. So there's a threaded rod that goes through here with a nut on either side so that the threaded rod has a metal thread to go on, which will make it turn much more easily. As expected, my new plywood samples both failed around the hole. So plywood isn't really a contender, and the strongest are the double mortise and tenon and the finger joint, both failing around the hole and sometimes failing here because I didn't reinforce them enough. The way this style of edge clamp works is they have an exponential spiral for the cam here that always applies pressure at the same angle here, corresponding roughly to the coefficient of friction of the pad here on the wood. Now, with Marius's clamp design, the weakest of the strongest design failed at 183 kilograms, so leaving at least a minimal margin of safety, let's say 150 kilograms. And drawing a force diagram, if we can apply 150 kilograms this way and we have a pressure angle of 18.5 degrees, because that's what Marius is using for the cam, that 150 kilograms results in a 50 kilogram upwards force here to get that diagonal force. And since we're pushing from both sides, we'll get twice that. So with 150 kilograms side push, we can do 100.4 kilograms vertical.
So the clamp's clamping force is always going to be about two-thirds of the spreading force on the frame.
So that makes me wonder, how does my bar clamp edge clamping hack compare to that? So let's see how much grip my bar clamp actually has on the edge. And my failure mode is the clamp kind of sliding out of these pads here. So I replaced those plastic pads with a little bit of inner tube rubber, but surprisingly, that actually did worse. So this edge clamp hack is good for perhaps 80 to 90 kilograms, whereas with Marius's design, I should be able to get 100 kilograms, but that's leaving a small margin of safety, less than a factor of two. And if my maximum load is exceeded, the clamp frame breaks, whereas here it just slides a bit. So realistically, I think this is actually stronger. Then I wanted to test the Bessie edge clamp frame to failure. And I figured the easiest way would be just to clamp it on something and pull it off until it breaks, but it took an awful lot of force and then it ended up sliding off. So I guess that edge clamp frame won't break if it's actually being used as an edge clamp. And then Marius built his 30 edge clamps using most of his tools, it seems, including his pantrorotor to cut cavities for metal nuts, his metal lathe just for shaping the ends of the threaded rods to make the washer stick on there, his 3D printer for the clamp pads, his wood lathe to make torsional springs for the jaws of the clamp, because those need to be spring-loaded to actually engage the workpiece. His bandsaw to cut slots for reinforcing. That reinforcement was actually the main takeaway from my test, because he was pretty sure the double mortise and tenon joint was going to be a good joint for it even before I ran my test. And gluing up precisely cut mortise and tenon joinery from the pantrorotor is always a treat. He also used the CNC router to cut the precise shape for the cams, including a little cavity for the springs to fit into. And then a layer of rubber onto the cams to really engage that workpiece better. And finally, a really nice metallic looking finish to finish his 30 edge clamps. And this was just a 1 minute montage of his clamp build video. His video is super detailed, really great video. Go watch it on his channel.
And next Sunday, Marius and I will be doing a live stream relating to these clamps, but that will be on his channel. So if you don't want to miss that, go subscribe to his channel, even if you don't mean to, because you can always unsubscribe after the live stream, although you probably won't.